Hi and welcome. This talk is Let's Not Play Dice, what scuba diving and IT security have in common. And I would like to start with a little introduction about myself and with the motivation for this talk. The name is Katzenfreund, and about 10 years ago I found someone actually paying me for doing IT security for them. In this 10 years I worked in application security, I worked for pen testing, I did architecture security, I ended up doing embedded devices security. And during that same time period, that's why this slide is so split screen like, I also did a lot of scuba diving. Ended up being a dive master, did quite a bit of wreck diving, tried cavern diving and ice diving earlier this year. And after a while, I noticed that some strategies that you find in the field of IT security, you also apply in scuba diving, and some of the scuba diving ideas nicely work together for IT security, if you adjust them a slight bit. And for this talk, I would like to share with you some of these ideas, and maybe you gain one or the other nice idea yourself for future use. Hi. So let's jump in. Don't be surprised, I will structure this as most projects work. So you meet your teammates, you hopefully plan what you're about to do, you do your tool setup, you discuss your configurations, you do your implementation, your change request, your patch, whatever your current situation is about, and you have some kind of closure where you might or might not reflect on what went good and where you would like to handle things differently in the future. This is exactly the same way that your dive works. You meet your group of divers for the day, you meet your buddy team, you do a briefing where you discuss, okay, what are we about to do on this particular spot? What would we like to see? What's everyone's experience? What's the weather conditions and whatnot? You assemble your gear. You hopefully have a very nice dive. And then you get out of the water. You do what is called a debriefing and discuss what you have seen, if everything went normal, what should be changed next time. And maybe you jump right in, because the only thing that matters after one dive is the next. So let's start with team forming. The important aspect here is that you understand the experience of your team, that you establish a common language, you speak about the same things, and you basically are able to understand what your teammates are trying to tell you. Experience to a high extent is based on what kind of tools can you use. Think about what network scanner you feel comfortable applying, what kind of programming languages everyone's preferred use is, what kind of scripting you like. Have you done something that is similar, maybe for a different client, but more or less the same project or a similar migration? Have you done a dive at the same spot earlier this year? Are you in a continued dive series with, I don't know, like 10 dives on one single wreck, because what you're actually looking at is some giant ferry, and with even 10 dives you can't cover the whole thing? How many experience does anyone in your group have is another important factor. That might be the number of dives, but that might also be, have you worked with a particular network equipment vendor before and understand how their CLI works? So have a fair understanding of what everyone in your group is good at, because it will also help you to understand, okay, where can I look for advice, and whom in that group can I approach to discuss an idea? The next two parts should be considered a little bit together, actually. The first one is establish a common language. In scuba diving, that's a more obvious thing, because you have a formal language by the means of hand signs. So if someone gives you a thumbs up, in most places of the world, you usually mean, okay, it's all right, continue, go on. If you'd now give me a thumbs down, I would assume, okay, this is a boring talk and you would all like it to have to do something else. Whereas underwater, if someone gives you a thumbs up or a thumbs down, it usually means, okay, I would like to get to the surface, please, or I would like to get down. Another very important thing is the definition of done. That's the terminology of a Scrum project. You might call it differently, but at the end, what is the important thing is that you have a common understanding is, what's the goal? What's the finish? Is it finished once your patch is implemented? Is it finished once you have an executable that you can run? Are you finished once this has been tested? Are you finished once you're out of the water? Are you finished once everyone is back at the dive base and you all took apart your gear and had debriefing? Just have an idea about that, because until that point, most people will have certain expectations towards your own behavior, and also they will react differently to whatever kind of interruptions there are. Last part, units. For vulnerability scanning, you might prefer CVSS, you might prefer CWS or DRED or whatever your metric of choice is. Funny thing that I remember is I overheard a conversation once where someone said, well, we should be quick here, it's a high vulnerability. Mm-hmm. Okay, understood. The guy he was talking to actually interpreted this as, well, it's high, it's not yet critical, I still have a couple of days to deal with it. So make sure you actually interpret on the same scale. A more obvious example, are you measuring your pressure in bar, are you measuring PSI? Unfortunately, outside the scientific community, most people don't use scientific imperials for everything. And then the example of half a tank, if you have regular equipment, this means 100 bar. If you have more modern equipment, or if you come from technical diving, that might be 150 bar, in military even 200. And it's always the exact same sign to indicate to your fellow divers, hey, half tank. But is that 100, is that 150, is it 200? Measured in time, that comes down to, I have 30 minutes to go, I have 10 minutes to go, I have 2 hours to go. So agree on something before you need that that sign, or you need to have that particular conversation. Okay, moving on. Let's assume you have a fair understanding about your team and you all start to plan what you're about to do. Something that helps a lot is to gather as much documentation as you can get on a particular dive site, on the network where you're about to work at, on systems that you need to interact with, on basically everything that can help you to understand what the environment you're about to work at or to dive at. For penetration testing, you would probably call that recon, so you try to gather any particular piece of information you can have on a certain area and on the individuals involved. Do that, take your time, every piece of information you gather here is handy later on. You might use that as a measure to work, even if the inventory management is not as properly as you would hope for, and you can add some information that is might not clearly written in the official documentation tools just because you took the time and checked the Git commits of the previous two or three development teams. For diving, look at the history of a WAG. Was it an ammunition transporter, or was it an oil tanker, or is it just some rich guy's sailing boat that for whatever reasons get down on that particular spot? It actually matters, because in one thing you can expect there to be things that are might still explosives. If it's oil, you definitely not want to get in contact with that, because if that gets into any piece of your equipment, it might be very bad for your equipment and then ultimately bad for you. And if it's some rich guy sailing, you might think about, okay, where can I get a good view? What is interesting here? And ultimately, in that way, get a better experience out of it. Speak with your team about similar things that they might have done for another client or the previous 10 change requests on that same network, because for some reason they do that job like forever. Has someone been on that dive site? Has someone worked with that particular peers beforehand? Are they familiar with the other individuals involved? Have that conversation and actually understand what they tell you. And if you do not have anything that is remotely similar, it's always worth to take a short look at GitHub or whatever your code trying inventory of choice is, just to get an idea on complexity and how someone else actually approached a certain problem. The last important aspect of planning that both of these themes have in common is you do a kind of threat modeling, okay, either by attack trees, by stride, by pastor, or whatever your weapon of choice is. You make that formally, you sort of rate that, and then you actually discuss, okay, how bad is it? Is it something that we need to avoid on all costs? Is it something that we find a compensating measure for? Is it something that at the end is just a little bit inconvenient, but ultimately not much of an issue? As a diver, you like to avoid situations where you're out of air. Ultimately, you usually have a plan B in case this happens, and that's to a very large extent, basically you rely on the fact that your body will not get out of air at the same moment that you do, and regularly check your air to avoid that situation, okay? And then consider, is it still bad? Okay, moving on. Setup and configuration. Two basic principles here. One thing is your own limits. The other thing is how familiar are you with your tools, your gear, your equipment, and the other stuff that you use. Your own limits basically is all the experience that you have gathered to a certain on a certain topic. That might be your first dive on 40 meters. That might be that you're for the first time ever working with Postgres. Or that might be that you just realize, oh, I'm a person who for some reason needs 30 minutes to wake up and to start thinking and to be able to think properly. And then maybe you should not be the engineer on call on your, in your team, because that's the guy who wake up at 3 o'clock in the night to fix an issue. Be honest about what you can do in these situations and understand where your limits are and where the limits of your team actually are. It says here, can you do math on 30 meters? For most people, interestingly, rather difficult. And the other thing is, I've heard someone saying recently, oh, I can't do math live. That's okay, you can avoid it. Just pre-calculate it, write it down, and have that with you in that situation. Reading is far easier than doing the math to it. Next part, know your tools. For IT security, obviously, what kind of tools do you use for scanning? What kind of tools do you use for version control? What's your programming environment of choice? Familiarize yourself with that. If you need to use that because it's the team standard or because someone else actually recommends it for you, or for some reason you're using some proprietary piece of software and that's literally the only tool that can do that, try to familiarize yourself with that in a more controlled environment. That might be a virtual machine that you set up for that particular case, that might be a Docker container that you launch. Do some testing, do a little bit of exploring here, and afterwards you just throw it away. That might be that you have never used a compass before, and that's okay. But then use it on the surface for the first time, preferably without a thick diving gloves. And you know, it's far easier if you actually realize it up front and not on the seaside, because then you can do it comfortably on your sofa. Far nicer. It also means understand where your tools become unreliable. You can't use everything that exists in the world of scuba diving for ice diving. That's just a more extreme case. Not every network scanner scales very well. Not every database should be used for distributed systems or can do good replications. Understand where the limit is and then choose something that seems appropriate and familiarize yourself with that before you move on. Okay, you will then come to the point where you actually need to do something. You do your implementation, you do your testing, your change, your whatnot. And now I would like to speak a little bit about different strategies that are in the field of security and that can be used in both worlds. First part is you can do you need a way to improve availability. And an obvious choice here is to make something more or less redundant. You can essentially replicate the exact same machine or the exact same system. You can have something that accepts the same input and generates roughly the same output, but is actually completely different. Both methods are fine and fair. However, in some cases, it might be enough to just have something on standby and you manually change to that. Okay, so you just start a different server, or you let's actually do the example here. Let's see if we can make that visible for you. These two elements, these two elements there are actually two different what is called a first station diving. So these are the units that reduce the pressure in your tank or cylinder down to something like 10 bars that you could technically use further on. These are not physically identical units, so they both have different specifications. And B, they do not switch over automatically, so you do not have something that is actually checking is the other device still available and working. You end up doing that manually by just taking something else, that's the other two photos, out of your mouth, switch to the other unit, put that in your mouth, and continue breathing. That simplicity saves you the necessity to have something that still checks if that other device is still working. So whatever you would use in security that usually has a heartbeat mechanism of some kind or a watchdog for the other mechanism or some kind of handshake that is continually running. And that feature you can avoid this way because ultimately that feature can fail as well. And with that introduction of more availability, you can actually have a reduced part of availability due to the synchronization or observation effects. And keep in mind when you have to double certain parts and sometimes you just can't avoid it, you in that way also need to do more maintenance work, you have more patching, you have tremendously more testing because you need to check and test that one additional feature that does that check, is the other device still here and functional or is it not? Whereas if you have just manual switch over, you don't need this component and you can save that time. And yeah, choose wisely and just don't try to overshot here. Moving on, integrity. In the IT world, you have a tendency to add Bluetooth to pretty much everything, right? You can have toys with Bluetooth. You can have, for some reason, ebook readers with Bluetooth. You can have, what have I seen? Thermostats with Bluetooth, or just some nice drinking bottles with Bluetooth so that they could actually tell you if you have drunken enough water on a particular day. We connect more and more, that's okay. And that way, we also reuse more and more features because we can just pull certain information on another service that has already implemented that particular information that we are looking for. However, if you take a look in more secure networks, we actually find that there's a tendency to keep that attack surface reduced. Okay, usually that's done by reducing the interfaces and the communication happening from a particular device. There's the security approach or the IT approach. If you check what is common in diving, you want more interconnection? Okay. You get more interconnection, but you keep the old one. I've used another example here, that's a pressure gauge. These two pictures are actually two things with the same feature. The one is measuring analog, how much air is left, the other one does the same thing digital. And usually, if you have the digital unit, you somewhere still have an analog one, basically because that transmitter is not wireless, so it doesn't need a battery which can fail. it can't for some reason be broken when you jump into the water and it just hit hard on the surface on a bad angle and you find yourself in 40 meters and figure, oh, I just can't do that anymore, bad luck. No, I just need to hope it's enough air. The diver's approach is to have it doubled. Might work in IT security as well in one or the other case. And important, the comparison usually is manual. It's not that we end up in the idea of having a safe comparer mechanism again. You basically check both your measurements at the just after one another. Measuring is key to our next part. Monitoring. I've seen a lot of projects where at some point they decided, oh, let's just log whatever the default is. Then you end up in an incident, you're like, oh, we either can't make sense of whatever we are logging, or for some reason it's not enough, or not what we actually are interested in. So it helps to early decide what you actually are interested in terms of data. Make sure you have that data, and then look at the data once in a not stressful situation and check if you can actually make sense of it. If it's whatever you expected, and if you can handle it sufficiently. If you find it's not the case, and you are, you know, it's a training situation, and you just look back and change that, it's fine. If you have an incident and you figure, oh, not the right data, yes, there will be a next one, there always is. But it's not best practice to wait for the next. It honestly doesn't matter how you measure it, if it's a dashboard, if it's a log file, if it's a pressure gauge, or just your dive computer. Check up front if you are able to make sense of whatever you're measuring. Okay, moving on. Exercises. If you practice something, it will help you to become better at it. That works for a lot of things. You can see a lot of examples here. Maybe you remember when you first tried to solder, you start with something fairly simple. Most people start soldering with a small grid of just wires. Choose easy examples if it's your first approach or make them a bit harder after a while. This is important because it will help you to remember the steps. It will help you to stay calm if you actually ever need to apply a particular ability. And depending on what you would like to actually practice or how complex it is, choose a good one, okay? A structured workthrough is something where you usually do not actually perform an action, but you just speak about it. This is very good if you have things that are, for real exercises, are either very, very extreme in amount of time that you would need or involve a lot of individuals. Of course, you can do red team versus blue team. You can also do your first aid training, and I hope you all do that regularly and not just for driving tests. You can do a rescue diver training, and basically everything where you actually do a movement will help you to remember it because your brain has a tendency to better remember things that are connected with some kind of movement in whatever way. Foolish example, most people have a tendency to better remember the movement to type their passwords as compared to the actual password. Okay, let's move on. Stay fit. That helps in the long term because it actually makes sure that you have a broader range of experiences to use from. You have different ideas, and sometimes just maybe one or the other plan B that you can pull from someone else's ideas. Typical things, attend a conference, good choice. Read an RFC, listen to a podcast. Scuba divers usually take stay fit rather literally, okay, because you actually need to be able to swim a certain distance. If you're a drift diver, you obviously want to be fit enough to swim against the current for a while. If you can't do that, speak with your team about it. Maybe you can just, as a buddy team, get up if one of you gets tired and get out of the current escape from this, and everyone else stays in that drift dive and you just meet at the surface. That's cool. Just have an idea of where your limits end here and try to have a recent idea, okay? I was able to do that 5 years ago is not a good answer. Last step, closure. When you have done your change request, your implementation, your whatever kind of project or teamwork, take the time and speak about what went nice and what we would like to handle differently. Try to not make it a shitstorm. Actually, speak open about what should be different. It doesn't need to be a formal meeting. It's cool if you do that at the coffee machine and everyone has a cup of coffee and after 10 minutes you're done. Just make sure you have that and that everyone had that chance to speak up their minds, essentially. What I find helpful is actually write that down and take a look at the things that you would like to do differently and how you would like to do them differently with a little bit of time in between, like 2 or 3 weeks tops. For auditors, there is the saying, if it's written down, it happened. If you write it down, you will make it happen. With that phrase, write it down and look at it later. Now I've spoken a lot about what they have in common. I would also like to point out a small difference here. When you paid attention, you probably noticed that from the classical CIA that there is in IT security, I completely left out the area of confidentiality. And unless you're a military diver, this is something that is completely nonsense if you do scuba diving. You want as many people as possible to know when your next where your dive is and what you planned. You literally deploy a large flag on top of the surface, making sure that the captain of this boat realizes, oh, there's someone in the water. I shouldn't stop here. When you do night diving or ice diving, you usually have someone else on the surface, completely briefed about your dive. When will you get in? What's the planned route? When will you get out? A good dive center actually should ask you something like, well, how long is your dive? Okay, 45 minutes. And how many minutes after 45 minutes you want me to call an emergency team? Okay, that's kind of grace period that you usually agree on, and yes, they actually do that. Another thing that is rather obvious, yes, we've seen we follow the same steps. However, the time span is completely different. A recreational scuba dive usually is limited to 1 hour. With briefing and debriefing and assembling of everything, you might have 2 hours tops. A bit more if you are experiencing something new, if you make a formal class, okay. But I've yet to find an IT project where the kickoff meeting is 2 hours or shorter. One last thing that I would like to mention is something I've just noticed when writing that slides. There are a lot more institutions that allow you to gain beginner's knowledge on how to do scuba diving compared to how many institutions there are that allow you to get into the world of IT security and get knowledge here in a particular field. Yes, of course, there are universities. However, they usually require you to have some kind of education beforehand to be enrolled. And I personally believe that Cyberry did a great job here to make that situation better for the IT security world. What else is different? Honestly speaking, pretty much everything, but I guess you all figured that by now. Okay, I promise if there ever is a CC3 workshop on how to do decent slides, this slide can be used as a bad example and I will attend it. With that, I'm open for questions or comments. We have a microphone here, or I can repeat your question, whatever you prefer. Thank you for listening.